Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents McMurks by Michael Anderle, narrated by Derek Shoales. Chapter 1. There were few things worse than staring at a letter that would be sent to the family and loved ones of the dearly departed. It was like looking into the eyes of the person who had passed away, and they asked her how she would deliver the news. Would she be cold and professional, or warm and compassionate? Phrased differently, would she be someone who helped or hindered the healing process? The experience was odd. Niki was only required to check the letter the agency had already written to make sure all the details contained therein were accurate and revealed no classified data. Once that was done, all she had to do was sign her name and send it off to be delivered. It wasn't something she would ever enjoy or get used to, but it was a part of the life that she had chosen for herself. Of course, it was also one of the reasons why she had issues with it. One of their cryptid hunts hadn't gone the way she'd hoped it would. While that was fairly standard when it came to these missions, as long as the monster was dead and wouldn't come back, her superiors called it a win. In the meantime, she was left with the unenviable task of looking at the harsh and even painful reality that two of the four hunters she had sent in hadn't returned alive. And the worst part was, it didn't need to happen. She sighed and signed the paperwork, as well as the letters to be sent to the next of kin. With slow, deliberate movements, she slipped each of them into the relevant manila envelopes, sealed them, and placed them in her outbox. At least, she reasoned, she didn't have to deliver them in person. The phone on her desk rang almost immediately and caught the attention of the agent seated at the desk across from her. "Agent Banks?" a man's voice said on the other side of the line. "This is Andrews from ground control on the last hunt. I want to make sure you've received the last mission reports we sent before we close up shop here."
"Yeah, I got them."
Niki realized that her tone was a little sharper than was necessary when he was quiet for a few seconds. Ordinarily, she kept a tight rein on her emotions, and while she could be scathing, it was almost always directed at the responsible party. It wasn't like her to snap at others like this, and it frustrated her even more that she hadn't seen it coming. "You know, we did all we could, right?" he said after a long moment. She sighed and rubbed her temples with her free hand.
"Yes, I know, and I don't blame you guys."
He acknowledged that with a grunt that might have been acceptance of her unspoken apology. For some weird reason, his lack of verbal response pushed her to provide an explanation. Like she wanted someone to understand the nagging frustration within that she couldn't fully understand yet.
"It's only that it was a little unnecessary and it pisses me right the fuck off," she said quickly before she could think it through. "My suggestion was to call in the cryptid assassin, you know, the guy who gets the job done on his own most of the time. But since the assholes in the offices upstairs can't bear to see their budgets mucked around with, they call in the dumbasses fresh off the boat from the zoo, put them in aging, decrepit suits of armor, and send them into unknown territory. Seriously, can you imagine that kind of disrespect? They spent years putting their lives on the line in that fucking jungle and are killed on their first mission on what should be safer home territory."
"Well, yeah."
"And that's not the worst part," she continued.
"The floodgates were open, apparently, and for better or worse, probably worse because she simply knew she'd regret it. The resentment demanded a voice."
"No, the worst part is that on top of that shit salad, we'll have to pay fatality benefits to their next of kin that will end up costing us twice as much."
"That's the worst part?"
"Well, no, but it's mixed in there with all the other straws that broke the camel's back. I'm not as upset at the payouts as I am at the truth that we shouldn't be in a position where we have to pay them at all. People died unnecessarily, and the fatality benefits are a reminder of that."
She sighed and tapped her pen on the desktop in an agitated rhythm.
"Anyway, yes, I got your report, thank you. Everything's tied up this side. And Andrews, thanks for doing what you could. And, for listening to me vent. Hopefully this will be the one and only time."
He chuckled, and she grimaced when she imagined the stories that would circulate around this conversation.
"I'll be in contact when we have another operation."
She slammed the receiver down, another rare indulgence. Damn it, she needed to get a handle on whatever this was. Still, if there was one good thing about the older models they still had in their offices, it was how satisfying it felt to thunk one down and vent a little frustration. They were sturdy enough to take the punishment. The agent seated across from her stared in silence, a confused expression on his face. His reaction was an uncomfortable reminder that she was acting out of character and needed to pull herself together.
"What?"
she snapped and shook her head.
"You know I'm right."
He coughed.
"What are you, sick?"
she asked.
"Get yourself..."
Niki stopped when she realized he had used the cough to cover the fact that he pointed at something behind her. Someone, rather, she decided, since inanimate furniture was unlikely to creep up on her. She turned her swivel chair, and her gaze settled on a tall, slightly rotund man with a receding hairline who stood in silence and simply regarded her with a raised eyebrow.
"Oh, shit, sir," she said, and winced inwardly at her crappy luck.
He would choose the one time she gave in and spewed her honest opinion to make an appearance.
I didn't see you there.
"Here's the part where you apologize for what you said." His tone carried a rumble of disapproval.
For a moment she considered it, torn between common sense and the voice of obstinacy within. Finally, she shook her head.
"I don't think I will. I meant every word of it. You guys fucked up."
He smirked in response.
"Well, in that case, I need to speak to you in my office at your earliest convenience."
Niki knew she would regret asking, but couldn't help herself.
"What about, sir?"
"About interesting intel that came in from Italy. Your earliest convenience, Banks."
Which meant right fucking now. She tried to show no emotion as her superior walked toward his office.
"Shit,"
she muttered as she tidied at her desk calmly. "It was nice knowing you," her colleague chuckled.
"Yeah, I'm a real fucking delight,"
she muttered under her breath as she pushed from her desk.
"Wait until I'm buried before you steal shit from my desk, Evans."
"Will do."
Elisa's phone rang yet again.
Why did it always ring when she was about to place her lunch order?
She pulled the device out of her purse and grimaced at the office number on the display. With a sigh, she pressed the answer button.
"Yes? Very cordial,"
a young woman said.
"I'm on my lunch break, Karen. What the hell is it this time?" "He wants to see you but didn't say why, only that it was urgent. He wants you in the office as soon as possible or he'll find someone else to take the job."
She snorted.
"Yeah, right. Like he would trust anyone else with something this important in our little operation." "Don't be like that, Elle. You know we're trying to get ourselves taken seriously in this business, and you also know that if you don't respond, he'll groom someone else to take your place. I suggest you get back here as quickly as possible."
"Fine,"
she sighed.
"I'm a little away, though, so I think it'll be about half an hour before I get back. I'll let him know."
Elisa hung up and slid her phone into her purse as one of the workers at the restaurant moved to the counter with her order.
"Lunch order for Elisa?"
the waitress called, almost like she didn't know who had ordered the food.
"Can I get it to go, please?" "Sure."
Traffic was hellish during the lunch hour, which gave her time to eat on the way to the office. It wasn't a pleasant meal, since it had to be interrupted every few minutes to drive her car through the Chicago traffic to the building where she worked. 20 minutes later, she pulled into the parking lot reserved for employees of the Cryptid-Inquirer. The name had always felt a little too on the nose for her taste, especially if they wanted to be considered as more than merely a tabloid by the journalism community. Maybe Cass would rethink it and rebrand their little venture before too long. She tossed the used takeout plate into the nearest garbage can and stepped into the elevator. Over the years, she'd honed a particular ability almost to an art form, and it had come in handy in the fast-paced life she had elected to live. People always expected her to look her best no matter when or where she was, and there were small tricks that enabled that, like a portable makeup kit in her purse, as well as a comb and scrunchies for her hair. It was quick work to comb her dark hair back, bind it, and touch her makeup during the time it took the elevator to reach her floor. It wasn't the kind of thing most people tended to think of, but they always forgot how much a long drive could ruin someone's look. The doors opened as she straightened her skirt, and she stepped into the hallway. The sound of telephones ringing and people talking at an elevated tone struck her like a wall. They were still a small operation, but after it had been bought out, the Inquirer had surged under the new management style. There had been a flurry of new hires, which brought their numbers up to almost 40. They would need to get bigger offices before too long.
"Elle, you took your time,"
the short red-haired secretary called as she emerged from behind her desk, which was piled high with paperwork.
"Cass is climbing the fucking walls waiting for you." "Well, that's what he gets for calling me during my lunch break,"
Elisa replied. She'd expected the line and had practiced her rejoinder on the drive.
"Do you know anything about what he wants from me?" "You'll have to find out when you talk to him. Good luck."
"Yeah, yeah,"
she muttered and didn't bother to knock on the door before she pushed into her boss's office. The lean man with short blonde hair was on the phone and motioned for her to take a seat in front of his smallish desk. The office smelled of the cigarettes he liked to sneak when he had the time. It was adorable how he thought no one knew simply because he got all the smoke into the vent next to his chair and drowned the place in air fresheners when he'd finished. He finally finished his call, hung up, and narrowed his eyes at her.
You know I could have given this job to someone else. Where the hell do you go to get lunch that it takes you half an hour to get back?
Well, for starters, it was mostly the traffic, which I usually avoid when I come back after my break since the lunch rush hour is over by then. And secondly, it's a little Greek place halfway to Schaumburg.
Why can't you go to a place nearby? Almost everyone goes to Pisano's.
I don't like deep dish pizza,
Elisa responded.
Hell, I don't like Chicago's hot dogs either. New York style is the worst and should simply be called tomato paste on toast. Oh, and I also think proper tacos should be made with flour tortillas instead of corn. Sue me.
I think you managed to piss off most of the damn country, including but not limited to most of Chicago, half the pizza lovers in the country, and every red-blooded resident of New York, Miss Falaci. Oh, not to mention virtually anyone who eats food in Mexico, too.
I'm opinionated. You know that. It's what makes me such a good reporter. Not to mention the best one you have on staff at the moment. So why don't you go ahead and tell me what you call me for during my lunch break and get on with it?
Cass laughed. They danced around like this fairly often. But like he knew, she was the best reporter he had on staff. She knew he was far and away the best and most talented manager she would ever have at this level.
Well, Elisa, let's get down to business. I'm sure you and the rest of the country know that a casino armored truck was held up at gunpoint by someone wearing mech suits of armor that are currently only in use in the zoo. While there are enough people in the world who want to know about the zoo monsters making their way through our country, there's a much larger audience out there. They want to know about the kind of people who would be able to stage a casino robbery while using tech that should be exclusive to the military.
Yeah, I hear they're already trying to get the filming rights for a movie, touting it as the new Ocean's 11 or something like that. Or was it a mix of James Bond and Ocean's 11? People have tried to give the heist genre that high-tech kind of boost. It's all well and good until you realize that the Las Vegas Police Department did precisely jack shit to find whoever that did it.
Yes, well, according to contacts I have in that very same Las Vegas Police Department, there might be a reason for that. As the story goes, according to those contacts, the people involved in the robbery have significant connections, both in the underworld of the city and also the local offices of the FBI. The kind of connections that would be able to kill any serious investigation into that kind of robbery. No one was killed, and the casinos were all thoroughly insured. The only people who want to have a look at the guy are the insurance companies, and surprisingly, they appear to like the pull he has.
Do you think it was an inside job? The mob still has any number of ties to the Vegas casinos, and if they wanted to get their hands on a neat little payout, they could have robbed their own armored vehicle, laundered the money, and taken the insurance payout.
Well, that's a very interesting take on the topic, one I'm sure our readers would like to hear about once you have the right amount of proof to back it up. The last thing we need while we struggle for legitimacy is a libel lawsuit on our hands.
Consider it done.
Elisa pushed quickly from her seat.
As soon as I can find tickets to Vegas.
I've already emailed your tickets to your account. I managed to upgrade you to business class, so it should be a comfortable enough flight. I expect you to make good use of that time.
I'll be nice and rested from the moment I touch down.
That's not really what I was talking about.
Oh, well, whatever you think I should be doing. When does the flight leave?
Take off from O'Hara's in 3 hours. Have fun in Vegas, Elisa, but not too much fun.
Will do, boss. I'll call you when I get there.
Her mind had already begun to consider the possibilities as she hurried away. The distraction allowed her to look past any irritation she might have felt at the fact that Cass had dragged her butt into the office for something he could simply have said over the phone. Of course, she was used to that. It was simply that he insisted on job discussions face-to-face for some weird reason, and her irritation was usually swept away by whatever assignment he doled out. Chapter 2 Niki took a deep breath and readied herself for what was to come. It wasn't likely to be a very pleasant conversation. Evans probably didn't know what it was about, so at least she was spared his comments. But very little intel came from Italy that was related to her. Of course, what did was unlikely to be good. She paused at the closed door, tapped it lightly, and hoped there would be no answer. It was, of course, a futile hope.
Come in.
With her expression schooled into calm and businesslike, she pushed the door open. Her superior was seated behind his desk. He wore a pair of reading glasses and studied a mission report, and he gestured for her to sit across the desk from him.
Special Agent Banks, thanks for speaking to me.
That sounds too formal to be good. Fuck, like I had any choice in the matter. Could he really be this pissed about me shouting my mouth off? Or maybe the problem is Italy, which is way worse. No problem, sir,
she said cautiously and resisted the urge to shift in her chair. He looked at her from over the rims of his glasses.
Anyway, to business?
Niki nodded and he closed the folder he had been reading and slid it across his desk to her.
I have a feeling you don't need to read what's inside to know what's written there.
What would give you that feeling, sir?
They had a relaxed work relationship, but her survival instincts told her now wasn't the time for jokes, even though a few sprang readily to mind.
The fact that your name features prominently, the Polizia di Stato had a couple of complaints about your actions during the liaison you had with their office.
Complaints? We killed all the monsters, which they were completely incapable of dealing with on their own. The mission, in their own words, was an unmitigated success. They were glowing in the report. I should know. I received a copy of it myself.
Yes, I'm sure they were. But a more thorough investigation produced troubling news. And before you say anything, I've done a little research of my own, so I'm well aware of what the two reports contain, and have verified certain facts for myself. These are the kinds of facts that should never be associated with the FBI, especially when it can potentially become an international incident. The second investigation was sparked by the death of a whole group of people in a nearby villa, which included the owner, who happened to be someone of a significant stature and something of a local celebrity.
I remember that. Our man on the ground,
McFadden, right? Taylor McFadden was the man you had on the ground?
Given that he's our best asset and it was our first international cooperative effort, I thought we should put our best foot forward, as it were. Anyway, McFadden reported that the beasts had already attacked that villa by the time he got there. He said
that it was the reason he was able to kill so many of them so quickly. They were distracted by the feeding frenzy. I'm sorry to interrupt you so often, but like I said, I have read the reports. I also have a good idea of when I'm being fed bullshit. I've written these kinds of reports dozens of times. I've been special agent in charge of my own task forces, and I know when people work to cover their asses.
He
held a hand up.
I'm not finished. Sending McFadden was clearly a mistake since, as I'm sure you're not aware, the man who owned the villa and was killed in the attack is a member of La Cosa Nostra, the same family your man has dealt with in the past.
Be that as it may, that Jason Momoa wannabe is still one of our best assets. Hell, he did more for this country when he was almost dead than those asshats on Capitol Hill do over their entire lifetimes. Damn it, that was not clever. When will I learn to keep my fucking mouth shut, or at least find a better way to say things?
Fortunately, her boss chose to ignore her outburst.
I don't disagree.
The man pulled his glasses off and placed them on the table.
Whether what happened in Italy was fully intentional or not doesn't matter. Something needs to be done to show that we're very, very sorry about what happened. We have taken pains to cultivate our government friends in Italy, so this has to be official to send the right message. In simple terms, you will be fired.
Niki clenched her fists on the arms of her chair and tried not to let her anger show. She had known all along that these were the possible repercussions for her actions, and had made her decision in the full knowledge that she could ultimately be fired. It still didn't make it any easier to hear, though.
I know that's probably difficult for you to hear. I also know that what you did was possibly in the best interest of your operation and task force.
Sure,
she responded, and barely managed to not clench her teeth.
I still have no idea why I'm being fired, but I do understand that sometimes office politics get in the way of keeping our country safe, as the Bureau is supposed to do.
Right. You don't know anything about what happened. Exactly like I don't know about people who are thoroughly impressed by your actions and would be interested in your continued service for your country, in a less politically impeded capacity. I also don't know anything about them wanting to contact you in the next 48 hours about that job opportunity.
Niki narrowed her eyes at the man and leaned forward.
Wait, am I being fired?
Sure, but a more accurate description would be released for other duties.
How about I release my 4-inch heels inside your ass?
Thankfully, she managed to refrain from saying that aloud by reminding herself that the outcome had always been anticipated, if not expected.
For now, you're reassigned pending a desk job,
he said when she made no effort to respond.
If you do that, I can guarantee I'll tender my resignation.
You can simply remain in place for the next 48 hours. I'm sure
I'll be in exactly the right place for someone to arrest me.
She raised an eyebrow at the man.
It sounds like you have a guilty conscience, he replied.
Maybe. But a more accurate description would be a cynical attitude.
He laughed and leaned back in his seat.
Very good, Agent Banks. That's the kind of attitude that'll serve you very well in the future. For now, though, I need you to clean your desk out and turn your badge and service weapon into the quartermaster's office on the 5th floor.
Niki stood quickly. She could, of course, go the HR route and drag the dismissal out indefinitely. There were protocols in place for this kind of situation, even when international politics were involved. Unfortunately, that kind of complicated and drawn-out situation didn't appeal to her. and she suspected her superior was counting on that. Aside from the fact that she'd effectively be in limbo for however long it took, she didn't want anything to affect the task force she'd worked so hard to create. More to the point, she'd prefer to not have too many questions asked over and above what had already been uncovered. That would shift considerable attention to Taylor and his team, which included Vicky. She could deal with what came her way, but there was no way she'd hang her cousin out to dry for a second strike that would end with her in the zoo. While she had no idea what his veiled references to other job opportunities might involve, her boss had basically told her she'd been fired in order to be hired elsewhere. Maybe all wasn't lost, although she would damn well look long and hard at whatever said opportunity might be. With a sigh, she straightened and looked him in the eye.
Well, I guess that's it then. Do you happen to know who'd take my position?
I can confirm that Agent Ramirez from the Dallas office will be relocated to take over thanks to his experience in aiding your task force in his area.
She nodded, impressed despite her resentment.
Ramirez is a solid choice. Not as good as me, but still.
I know. I recommended him myself. Have a good day, Banks.
With nothing left to say, she stepped out of the office. Her hands shook and her fingers hurt from being held in tight fists for so long, and she dragged in a long, slow breath. The hallway was empty, thank goodness, and it gave her an opportunity to restore her usual calm and focused attitude. She'd already betrayed herself once too many times, and whatever emotional bug had crawled up her ass, it was time to be rid of it. She wouldn't give anyone the satisfaction of another emotional reaction. Her last action with the Bureau would be a successful personal mission of professionalism, with her head held high and her dignity intact. The control over herself was maintained as she entered the building elevator and when she stepped into the Quartermaster HQ. There wasn't much to see except for a tempered glass window in the wall with a small opening at the bottom. She filled out the requisite paperwork and turned her service weapon and her badge over to the man on the other side. Nothing was said about the process, which didn't mean much. Agents who were suspended pending internal affairs investigations, as was likely happening in her case, were required to remove all ties to any investigative work they might have. Niki noted her hand shaking a little as she placed the required items on the counter and pushed them through the small opening. She turned quickly and headed to the elevator again. The garage was her next destination, and she maintained her control during her walk toward her SUV. Only once she was inside and the door was closed did she finally allow herself some reprieve. She hammered her fists on the steering wheel of the car and the vehicle shuddered. "Fuck!" she shouted as loudly as she could. No one was in the garage at this time of day, and even if they were, they wouldn't hear the racket. After a few repeats, her throat was a little sore, and so were her hands when she finally relaxed against the car seat. But she did feel a little better. Her career was all but finished, and all because she couldn't resist giving McFadden a helping hand in his little vendetta. It still felt like the right choice, despite the repercussions. Even so, she wished she could take it out on Taylor as much as possible, and let him know what her helping him had cost. A part of her wanted to make him feel guilty about it, but her habitual honesty challenged that head-on. She had made the decision herself and insisted she tag along. He had given her the opportunity to back out, so no one was more responsible for her current situation than she was. Given that, it was also unlikely that he'd feel even slightly guilty, and she had to acknowledge that his pragmatic attitude would be justified. Niki pulled her phone out of her jacket pocket and found her sister's number quickly. She needed someone to talk to about this whole situation, and Jenny was the only name that sprang to mind. Worries about problems with national security secrets didn't quite apply in this case, as the woman probably already knew about everything that was happening anyway. It was a good thing that she was on their side. The kind of damage the girl could do if she ever chose to was the stuff of nightmares. Not Nikki's nightmares, necessarily, but definitely someone's. Most corporate security directors and advisors, if she had to guess. Her sister answered the phone almost immediately.
Hey, big sis. Do I need to tell you about what happened, or have you already broken a few federal laws finding out about it already? The laws were broken a long time ago. I merely like to keep myself apprised of what's happening with my family. So when any new paperwork with your name on it pops up, I get an alert. It's probably not a very efficient use for the software I designed to get it done, but I don't have any other purpose for it, and better in my hands than the wrong hands. Your hands are the wrong hands, just not the worst hands.
There was a moment of silence between the two sisters. Niki stared ahead into space, not seeing anything, but still wanted to talk to her sister.
Hearing Jenny calmed her somewhat.
I'm sorry, Niki,
the woman said softly.
I know I make jokes about your work with the FBI, but I know you cared about it, and it meant a lot to you. I'm sure you were making the world a better, safer place for all of us, but that's a lesser concern, to my mind at least.
Thanks, sis. And yeah, it sucks all kinds of balls to see everything I've worked for over the course of my career turn to shit over one action.
I know that. And the fact that you did what you did to protect me and Vicky, don't think any of that is lost on me.
Niki chuckled. You don't fuck with my family and get away with it. Not while I'm still breathing. So, no, I don't regret doing what I did. I knew the consequences very well when I made my decision, and I'd do it again. It still sucks, though.
Well, I hope you know that I won't stand idly by and let you retire with no pension. I'm sure I could get you a job with my firm if you wanted. They're always looking for former law enforcement to head security at their various installations.
I actually have a few leads on the job for myself.
Jenny paused, likely trying to research the statement.
Have you been contacted by headhunters already?
Something like that. Is this line secure?
Another voice connected.
I've already secured the line, Agent Banks,
Desk said.
It's not agent anymore. I don't think, anyway. My supervisor told me to stick around for the next 48 hours, like he thought I would be contacted by someone about continuing my line of work. His exact words were a less politically impeded capacity when describing the possibility. Given that you've not seen any orders for my arrest yet, I'll guess he wasn't lying, and there might be something to what he said.
Jenny didn't answer immediately, and she knew that to mean her sister was probably typing on her computer, digging in the vast number of databases she had on hand to find what she wanted. It was a little terrifying to think that almost any information in the government was accessible to the woman.
I don't pick up anything right away,
Desk asserted after a few minutes. She'd forgotten the damn AI for a moment, who would no doubt mirror the actions of the hacker she'd been based on.
I'll do a little research and get back to you.
Niki shook her head.
Don't worry about it. I don't want any more trouble to go into what happened.
It's no trouble,
the AI assured her.
It's what you do for family, after all.
Desk disconnected from the line, and Niki couldn't help but make a face.
Do you think she might be getting a little too personal? Desk knows she's not real, right?
She's been programmed with a large part of my psyche,
Jenny explained.
That's why she's so protective of you.
And I guess that's where the infatuation with Taylor comes from, right?
I was hoping you wouldn't notice.
Niki snorted.
Yeah, right.
Niki looked up from her screen and frowned as the alert from her phone was brought up on the screen to her left.
Hey, Bungies, are we expecting any new deliveries today?
The man stepped away from the suit he was working on and removed the safety glasses he wore while Tanya paused her work with a soldering gun. The protective eyewear was unnecessary, but Taylor insisted on it anyway. It had simply become a habit they all accepted without complaint. What? He responded. Isn't it your job to keep track of when and where we're supposed to pick up new deliveries?
Well, yeah, but there's no delivery scheduled for today,
she told him.
And yet a delivery truck is pulling into our backyard for some fucking reason.
Front yard, technically, Taylor commented as he came down from his room while he still pulled his shirt on. And yes, we do have a delivery today.
But there's nothing on the schedule,
Niki insisted.
And I should know since I compiled the damn thing.
Oh, this isn't a business delivery, at least not for McFadden's mechs.
God, that name sucks,
the hacker protested.
I know, but it's better than nothing, he agreed. Anyway, we have something to look at. If neither of you is too busy, which, as your boss, I can say that you're not, come have a look.
Taylor, Bobby, Vicky, and Tanya walked out into the blazing Las Vegas sunlight as the truck beeped and backed up to a different section of the building.
Of course, you all know I'm working on regaining the muscle mass I lost while lazing around in the hospital, Taylor said as he slid a pair of sunglasses on. And I wondered if the best way to go about it was to simply go to someone else's gym and pay them a monthly fee, or whether I could purchase the equipment on my own and charge other people to use it.
Bobby stared as the delivery team began to carry the items into a separate area, one that wasn't connected to the shop. Wait, so you went out and decided to build your own gym? I thought you were only spitballing with that idea.
Well, I was, his boss admitted. But then I thought about it and realized that having the kind of stuff we need in our area would be a great way for us to stay in shape, and maybe even make some money off it.
Have you thought about what we need to do with our security system if we have to account for a horde of chicks in yoga pants who wander in at all times of the day to sip their healthy smoothies and talk about their alkaline levels?
Niki asked, her arms folded across her chest.
That is an excellent point, he agreed. And I have thought about it. But since we don't have the mob on our backs anymore, we might not need as much.
We'll still need some, Bobby reminded him. We don't work on fakes made in China out here, after all.
Taylor shrugged. Right, so I haven't worked out all the kinks, but we have time for that later. It's not like I've advertised an opening date. For the moment, we can use them ourselves. We all need to keep ourselves in tip-top shape, none more so than me. And I can't think of a better way to use some of the 80,000 feet that aren't currently occupied in this strip mall. So, what do you think? The unused 30,000 feet here, or the 50,000 over on the end?
The truck loaders finished their work quickly, which meant they wouldn't build any of the equipment. As lunch break time was approaching, Taylor's crew chose to start building them once they had ordered food at his expense. Vicky was less than pleased about the situation and wiped her forehead as she worked on one of the elliptical machines.
Seriously, how obtuse do you have to be to make IKEA instructions seem like NASA documents?
How the hell do you know what NASA documents look like? Bobby asked and took a bite from the pizza that had been delivered. She paused and regarded him with an impatient expression.
Don't worry about it. The point is that these instructions are completely obtuse. Fucking hell.
Even if the instructions are difficult to understand, the machines themselves are intuitive,
Taylor said, finishing one of the squat machines and patted it and the weights to be sure.
Basic engineering gives you a good idea of what's supposed to be where to emphasize exercise and safety.
Well, tell me that again when I have an engineering degree,
the hacker grumbled as she twisted some of the screws in.
After all, I don't get all up in your business about not cleaning the spam from your email.
Okay, if you don't want to work in here, we could... Wait a second, how do you know about the state of my email?
She raised an eyebrow at him.
Come on, man. The fact that you think any part of your life is even remotely private at this point is adorable. Be happy that I have your best interests at heart and assimilate that into your life already.
Whatever, he mumbled. Anyway, if you don't want to work on this, you can head to the shop or maybe to school. This lunch was supposed to thank you guys for helping me here, but if you're not into it...
Don't be like that,
she whined, straightened, and stretched her hands. It appeared she was finished with the elliptical.
You know I'm in this for the long haul, but get used to the fact that I'll bitch and complain about it the whole way.
Oh, well, I appreciate that. Besides, you could probably put all this equipment to work to good effect. For instance, making your boobs larger or smaller.
Vicky narrowed her eyes pensively.
Okay, I get how I can make them smaller. It's only subcutaneous adipose tissue. But how the hell would exercise help to make them larger?
Not make them bigger in real terms. I'm fairly sure the only way to get that is through surgery. But make them look bigger, Taylor explained. Exercising properly can firm and tone the chest muscles behind your breasts and help improve your posture, which will help with the...
The presentation, yeah, I got it.
She finished for him as his voice trailed off.
Fair enough, I might look into it. Not that I have any complaints about the gals in question, but there's always room for improvement. By the way, has anyone ever told you that you might have an unhealthy fixation on the size of a woman's chest area?
Tanya, who had been quiet for most of the conversation, barked a laugh. Taylor, on the other hand, showed no sign of being bothered in the slightest.
Fixation? Yes. Unhealthy? No. When you think about it, the whole fixation coming from when we're babies and seeing them as a source of food is probably bullshit since straight women and gay men don't have it. But there's an evolutionary idea behind the attraction. It's an indicator of the woman's health and provides other markers that would show she's a healthy mate. The need to mate solely for reproduction might be gone, but that kind of instinctive check to see if the mate is healthy will still be there for a long while. It's a similar reason as to why men have evolved larger penises than average in the animal kingdom, compared to their size anyway.
Some men,
Vicky retorted.
I've never heard any complaints.
You have to understand,
Tanya said while she helped to put the weights in place on one of the shoulder exercising machines.
There are certain things a woman can take advantage of when it comes to her natural gifts. Having a guy stare at your chest means they won't watch your face or your hands. That can be amazingly useful. You have to use the gifts Mother Nature has given you.
Taylor pointed at the woman.
She has a point, you know.
I don't think that's right.
The hacker scowled as she began to help him with one of the treadmills.
Fair enough, if you have it, flaunt it, but intentionally using your natural gifts as an advantage, much like you do with your natural talents for software engineering,
Tanya interrupted.
That's not the same thing. You have to work to be good at something like that. Using a guy's natural attraction doesn't feel right.
The other woman raised an eyebrow.
Well, the lion is naturally attracted to eating the gazelle. Does that make it wrong? That's not the same thing, and... You're fucking with me, aren't you?
Vicky scowled as the woman laughed again and returned to work with bungees.
Well, haha, you're very hilarious. And why the fuck are you taking Taylor's side in this?
Tanya shrugged.
I'm not taking anyone's side in anything. I have a kid, and it seems like all children have a way of seeing the world when they're younger that makes us older folk want to slap knowledge and experience into them. Or, failing that, simply slap them.
The hacker shook her head.
So what? Is my age a trigger for you or something? No, only your ignorance.
The other woman replied with a cheeky smirk and ducked to avoid the screwdriver thrown across the room at her. By now, the girl's propensity to throw things was anticipated, and her aim was so bad they were easily avoided. Taylor grinned, although he didn't add anything to the conversation. Vicky was much closer to him and less likely to miss if she decided to throw something at him, but she'd absorbed enough from his talks about safety to put no power behind her impromptu weapons. He hoped she'd simply outgrow the habit sooner rather than later. Thankfully, the phone rang, and the hacker retreated to the office, but gave Tanya a one-fingered salute as she hurried out. The woman laughed in response and offered her fist for Bobby to bump. Bungees appeared less amused by their antics, and rolled his eyes, but still pressed his closed fist reluctantly to hers before the three of them returned to work. Chapter 3. It wasn't that she didn't feel safe in her own home anymore. Paranoia was a part of the business, of course, but Niki was suddenly more than aware of the fact that someone was probably out to get her. Not necessarily to kill her, but quite probably to arrest her or worse. Even so, it was better to be alert and ahead of the problem. If it meant taking an extra long time to have a coffee at the shop across the street from her apartment, so much the better. Besides, the venue sold good coffee and was where she went to buy something each morning before she headed to work. Things had changed now that she didn't have anyone to work for, but the staff knew her well enough to let her remain in the little booth next to the window. She lingered, watched, and waited, while she hoped nothing would happen. Damned if hoping would be the end of her, though. She leaned back in her seat and took another sip of the lukewarm coffee she'd ordered almost an hour before. During the long stakeout, who had to stake their own home out anyway? She had nibbled at most of the blueberry muffin and was likely the kind of patron these stores disapproved of, but she chose not to worry about that. One thing at a time was more than enough. Years of working with the government had taught her to notice their people from a mile away. It was mostly the subtle way they carried themselves, and the icy demeanor of superiority they exercised whenever they were in contact with a member of the general populace. There was also the fact that they drove into an area, pulled their big black SUV onto the sidewalk, and exited with the knowledge that there would be no tickets in store for them. Seriously, these guys needed to be much more subtle. Niki tried to get a better view of the two men who exited the vehicle that had parked in front of her apartment building. They seemed in a rush and obviously already had the code to enter the building, which was suggestive of what they tried to do.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.